Last week I shared, stay awake. Mark 13:37, Jesus warned us to stay awake. Even Mary Go understand the message. Stay alert. I give you 4 points. Be ready. Live today. Live knowing God is in control. And live like Jesus is coming back. And very soon. Then I share the story about moving the chair. You remember that? Good. Last week after second service, someone come to me and a dear brother said, "Wow, your message is good. Very good for the great spring cleaning before Chinese New Year." Ever since then, I've been praying for this brother. You can join me to pray for him. Martin Luther said, "Live as if Jesus was crucified yesterday, rose from the dead today, and is returning tomorrow." This morning, we want to spend time on 1 Peter chapter 4, the whole of chapter 4. Remember, Peter is one of the four that sat with Jesus at Mount of Olives in Mark 13. He heard Jesus' message. 30 years later, around AD 60, he penned this letter for the believers scattered through Central and Northern Asia Minor. Because the people are suffering persecution. They are being mocked, slandered. So Peter wants to write this letter to encourage them in the face of persecution so that others can see the true grace of God in their lives. Father, this morning as we come, may you make 1 Peter 4 so clear to us so that we can open our eyes and ears and hearts to hear you and to behold you and soften our lives, our will, our feet, so that we can follow you wherever you want us to go. In Jesus' name, amen. What's the aim of 1 Peter 4? The aim of 1 Peter 4 is for Peter to challenge the believers who are going through difficult times to live the rest of the time, their lives, for the will of God. Not just for the believers in early AD 60s, but also believers today, that we'll live our lives, the rest of our time, for the will of God. 1 John 2:17 says, "And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever." Abides forever. A.W. Tozer says, "Let us be alert to the season in which we are living. It is the season of blessed hope, calling for us to cut ties with the world and build ourselves on this one who will soon appear. He is our hope, a blessed hope, enabling us to rise above our times and to fix our gaze upon him." With that, we want to move quickly to verse 7, the heart of 1 Peter chapter 4. Peter says, "The end of all things is at hand." Remember, I said that Peter was at the hill, the mountain of Olives, hearing Jesus. He connected the end with prayer. He says, "The end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be self-controlled and sober-minded for the sake of your prayers." Edrickson version, right? Now it's a Hock, Chye Standard Bible. "Now the time, end of all things is near. Therefore, be serious and disciplined for prayer." That is Holman Christian Standard Bible. Be serious and disciplined. So I bring you my first point. Keep your head clear so that we can pray. Keep your head clear so that we can pray. What do we pray for? Pray that we will seek God's will, understand God's will, and do His will for the remaining of our time here. We need to be serious and disciplined. Jesus said the same thing in Luke 21. He says, "But watch yourself, lest your hearts be weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and cares of your lives, and that they come upon you suddenly like a trap." Jesus said that dissipation in life, drunkenness in life, demands in life, if you are not careful, will trap you. And we are in the trap, we have a hard time getting out of the trap. "For it will come upon all who dwell on the face of the whole earth. But stay awake at all times." Again, the alert. "Praying that you may have the strength to escape all these things." All this that is referring to listed in verse 34. Dissipation, drunkenness, and demands of life. "Pray that you may have strength to escape all these things that are going to take place, and then we can stand before the Son of Man." So keep your head clear, pray, be self-controlled and disciplined. Be sober-minded and serious. Sober-minded means to be connected with reality. A person who is drunk are not in touch with reality. Peter encouraged us to be sober-minded. What is the end result? That we will not be weighed down by dissipation, drunkenness, and demands of life. Is prayer your steering wheel or your spare tire? Is prayer your steering wheel or spare tire? Church, we need to pray. We need to keep our head clear so that we can continue to ask God to reveal to us His specific will for each one of us, so that we can pursue that. And because that one will last forever. Point number two, keep your heart warm. We need to love. Verse 8 says, "Above all, keep loving one another earnestly." Earnestly means earnestly. Earnestly means with sincere and intense conviction. Very serious. Not masa-masa. Another version says, "Keep fervent in your love for one another with a special degree of love." We are all called to love our enemies. But we are called to love earnestly the saints, one another. Romans 12 have this to say, "Love from the center of who you are, the core of who you are. Don't fake it." You know why? Because people know. "Run for dear life from evil. Hold on for dear life to good. Be good friends who love deeply. Practice playing second fiddle." Second fiddle is a concept developed in the 19th century. It's used in the violin circle. Second fiddle is a person that support the first violinist. So in an orchestra, the person who sits on the left closer to the conductor plays the first violin and sits on the first chair. The second fiddle sits on the chair behind the first chair. I was told, in the event that the string of the violin for the first chair is broken while he or she is playing, the second fiddle will pass over the violin to the first violinist. His job is to make sure that the first chair succeeds in his job as the first violinist. We are encouraged to help one another to succeed. Verse 11, "Don't burn out." While doing so, don't burn out. "Keep yourself fueled and aflame. Be alert servants of the Master. cheerfully expectant. Don't quit in hard times. Pray all the harder. Help needy Christians. Be inventive in hospitality. So keep your heart warm. We need to love. We need to love one another deeply. We need to let our depth of our love absorb all the consequences and effect of sins. We are all fallen. We will rub each other differently. We will make each other angry. We will misunderstand one another, but allow the love to cushion that so that we can continue to nurture the relationship and help each other to succeed and help others succeed. And don't burn out. Don't quit. Don't burn out. Don't quit. My third point is keep your home open. Share. Show hospitality to one another without grumbling. You decide. You need to decide to be hospitable. I cannot decide for you. I cannot tell you that you are all invited to Jeffrey Goh's house for lunch today. Are we invited? Yes. I'll get his address later on. I cannot help Jeffrey, our brother Jeffrey, to be hospitable. You need to decide for yourself to be hospitable. Teacher was asking a student a question. If you have $1 and you ask your father for another dollar, how much do you have? The student said, $1. The teacher told the son, to the student, you do not know your math. Came the reply, you do not know my father. Don't be like the father. Share. Keep your home open. Be hospitable. Be generous. Without grumbling and cheerfully. I learned the idea of giving from this Old Testament passage many years ago. And I find it's very powerful. It's about giving money, but I think the principle can be applied in our lives to give anything, to share anything. So Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 7 says, but if there are any poor Israelite in your town when you arrive in the land the Lord God is giving you, do not be hard-hearted or tight-fisted towards them. Instead, be generous and lend them whatever they need. Do not be mean-spirited and refuse someone a loan because the year of canceling debts is close at hand. So Israel have a law that at the seventh year, all the debt is being canceled. I wish the bankers in our midst will hear this and somehow apply that, and all of us will rejoice. Yeah? If you refuse to make the loan and the needy person cries out to the Lord, you will be considered guilty of sin. So the Lord is saying that if someone come and borrow money from you, and you know that the seventh year is coming, don't ever entertain the thought that if I lend it to this fella, next year I need to cancel the debt. Wow, loogie, huh? So I refuse the loan. God says, if you refuse to make the loan and the needy person cry out to the Lord, you'll be considered guilty of sin. Then verse 10 tells us what to do. Give generously, even though it is the sixth year. Give generously to the poor, not grudgingly. For the Lord your God will bless you in everything you do. Even if you lend the loan and the person cannot return you back, God has a way to return that manifold back to you. There will always be some in the land who are poor. That is why I'm commanding you to share freely with the poor and with other Israelites in need. If a fellow Hebrew sell himself or herself to be your servant and serve you for the 6 years, In the seventh year, you must set the servant free. When you release a male servant, do not send him away empty-handed. Give him generous farewell gift from your flock, your threshing floor, and your wine press. Share with him some of the bounty with which the Lord your God has blessed you. Remember that you were once slaves in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God redeemed you. That is why I'm giving you this command. So I learned 4 lessons. Guard your selfish heart in the area of sharing and giving, because we are selfish people. Stop your grieving heart. Don't grieve when you extend the help. You see, selfishness will hit you before you give. Grieving heart will hit you after you give. But develop a generous heart. Why? Because God reminded the Israelites that He is the one who have brought them out of Egypt, because they need to stay grateful. So I submit to you these 4 principles that help us, to remind us, to help us to share and to give. My last point is, keep your hands busy. Serve. Keep your hands busy. Serve. Verse 10 to 11 says, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another. As good stewards of God's varied grace, whoever speaks, as one who speaks the oracles of God, whoever serves, as one who serves with the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. In this verse, I learned that everyone has gifts. Everyone has gifts. A boy came to a pastor and said, "Pastor, I discover I have one gift." The pastor gently said, "What gift is that, boy?" The boy said, "It's a gift of criticism." Pastor wisely replied, "The Bible says that the guy who have one talent went out and buried it. Maybe that's what you ought to do. Do not bury your gift. If your gift is not criticism, but any other gifts, don't bury it. Use it. Our gifts are given for us to use them. When you use them, it demonstrates God's varied grace among us. How many of you would love for your neighbor to exercise his or her gifts so that you will be the beneficiary of God's grace? How many of you? Only 10. Okay, good. Let me repeat my first point again. I'm sure all of us would love for our neighbors to exercise his or her gifts. Because if the Bible is true and we believe it, then he says that God's varied grace can be channeled and will be blessed. But your neighbor also wish that you and you and you use your gifts. So if all of us use our gifts that God has given us, then I think we have the full spectrum of varied grace that is available for us. I think this church will be a better place than before, because the whole spectrum of varied grace is available for us. At the end, God gets the glory. We enjoy using the gift. Isn't it beautiful? Hebrews 6:10 to 12 says, "For God is not unjust as to overlook your work and the love that you have shown for His name in serving the saints, as you still do. And we desire each one of you to show the same earnestness to have the full assurance of hope until the end, so that you may not be sluggish, but imitators of those who have true faith and patient inherit the process. So God don't just give us gifts. He empower the gift user. He give words for people who are using our mouth to serve, to teach, to preach, to encourage. He gives strength for people who come alongside to support. At the end, God even guaranteed the result. He will get the glory. This morning, I have the privilege of inviting two of my friends to come on stage to share their journey as they step out to serve. So can you put your hands together to welcome Jean and Esther to come forward to the stage. Church, let's give them a hand again. This is Jean, a banker in Citibank. Did you hear what I said just now?
7 years. Seven years.
Good. Do something about it. And this is Esther. Jean, would you want to kind of give a simple introduction of yourself?
Okay, my name is Jean. I'm married to Lee Shen, and we have two young children, Kaylin and Kylin, who are 3 and 6. I work in Citibank as an offshore RM relationship manager that manage clients' funds who are overseas. And I'm the cell leader of LFC for the past 2 to 3 years. It's called Living Faith Cell. It consists of couples, married couples with kids between 0 and 6 years old.
Esther?
Hi, my name is Esther. I'm from Bethesda Care and Services.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. I'm married. I have 2 young children, 2 girls, 8 and 7 years old, and with BCS about 7 years, and I joined a cell group called Living Stone number 5.
Very good. I heard Living Stone is a great cluster.
Very, very great.
Well, there's a common factor among 3 of us. All of us have daughters. Did you say amen? Those who have boys, please work harder. Huh? I want to be having my son-in-law soon. So, Jean, tell us, what do you do? When do you make the decision to step up to serve?
This was about 2-3 years ago. So I was very comfortable at the point of my life. I was cruising. I was doing the standard thing. We got married, kids, focused on career. But I realized we cannot cruise. Because in terms of we are cruising, in actual fact, we are actually backsliding slowly but surely. So I wanted to challenge myself, and one way is I needed commitment to do something. So I stepped up, Elder Hock Chye challenged me to step up, and I said, okay, I'll take more responsibilities. So because as a cell leader, you can't give excuses. As a member, you can say, I'm tired, I don't go to cell group. But you can't do that as a cell leader. You are the cell leader, you have to be there. So these...
Can don't attend cell group, Amir?
I have to be there. Yeah.
Okay.
So,
what is your cell group name again?
LFC. LFC. Okay. So yeah, this was the kind of responsibilities I slowly took, and it was a learning curve. It's a learning journey for me and my wife to take up more responsibilities, to learn and to grow as a couple and as an individual.
Okay. Esther, when do you step up to serve and tell us a little bit more?
Actually, last year I start to serve in Hokkien because I think that God has blessed me a little gift. I can speak Hokkien, so I think I want to serve in this area.
Yeah. You want to try?
Yes. Okay. Whenever you meet Pastor Sharon, you say "Kwa diao li diao ho," right? Yeah. "Kwa diao li diao ho." Yeah, in Hokkien ministry.
"Kwa bo lu to
ko." To ko.
Yeah. I think I also can serve in Hokkien.
Can.
Now, I understand that you also sign up for music training, vocal training, in order to serve.
Yes. I love singing. 2 years ago, I actually signed up for vocal training because I want to serve in worship ministry. So I want to give God my best. So, you know, you can hear, right, my voice very low. So, you know, I got difficulty in singing high. So I went for vocal training and I want to serve in Hock ministry.
Yeah. Wow. So you get equipped in order to give your very best.
Yes. Yes.
Wow, amazing. Yeah. And then we stay with you for a little while. I understand that you, this is also not a an easy season for you. You have cancer in 2014 and then relapse again.
I have, in 2014, I was diagnosed with stage 1 breast cancer. Then last year, 2018, it relapsed again. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So.
Is it hard for you to just step out in the midst of all these challenges?
Yes. I think the most challenging is because every day I'm taking the medication, so sometimes my body will sit in of tiredness. Mm. But I choose to serve because I want to set a role model for my children. Mm. You know, I want to serve. And at the same time, while serving, I focus on God, but not my condition. Mm. You know, if I stay at home and rest, I think I'll get worse. I want to serve because I focus everything on God. It's God focused, but not myself, not my condition. Yeah.
Praise God. Yeah. Praise God.
Yeah. Thank you.
Back to you, Jean. When you decide to serve 2 years ago, step out, that was a sweet spot in your life, right? I mean, have you ever wondered why serve? I mean, why don't you work harder, earn more money, and those things?
I've been a Christian for about 25 years. And I realize as part of growing, I need to apply what I've read and I've learned. And I used to have this misconception that leaders have to be perfect. You have to be fully equipped and ready to serve, which is not true. I mean, we're all works in progress. And even for myself, I'm always learning to manage better, to what to teach the cell group and all that. So it's always been a journey for me.
Okay.
And 2 years ago, me and my wife, we decided, the purpose of life cannot be always on making more money. In Singapore, it's not cheap. But our purpose is not to make more money, to get a bigger house, a bigger car, focus on career. And I realized that it's wrong. That to the world, that is success. You have a big car, you got a big house, you have a big title. But what God calls us to be is not that. That is not the definition of success. So me and my wife, we challenge ourselves that this is not how we should define success as children of God. And therefore, we decide to shift our focus to be more Christ-like. So there was a mental shift internally for us.
So was there any adjustment for you and your family and as you step out to serve?
Yes, there were adjustments to be made because my kids are still quite young, 3 to 6. We first thought it was impossible to serve with young kids, but it's not true. It is possible. With the help of our friends, family, with God's help and His grace, we are able to serve. I think one example we did as a cell group, because my cell group consists of young kids 0 to 6, was to serve in Meals on Wheels. We committed once a month, the third Saturday of each month, to serve. and we saw ourselves more than just the Deliveroo guys who just deliver food, but to be the face of the church, to reach out to the old folks there, to give them food, to say that, hey, we are from BBTC. We care about you. So that is possible. That is entirely possible. Mm-hmm. First thought is, it's really difficult, but even after 1 year, the feedback for our cell group is that this is something they want to do as couples with young kids, to show and bring along their young kids to the entire process of Meals on Wheels, to show their kids that, hey, it is possible to start serving even when they are 3 years old or 4 years old. This is possible.
So you expose them when they are young.
Yes, that's young.
And they learn
what you are
doing.
Yes.
It's marvelous. Yeah.
So I mean, as heads of households, we need to set the standard for our kids and our wives. So this is one way we say that, okay, to show that we are serving, not just coming in on Sunday or going for cell group, but to show in action to the kids that we need to serve.
Fantastic.
During this cancer journey, I also have burden for people who diagnosed with cancer, especially those newly diagnosed. I journey with them, I pray with them, you know, and hold their hand and walk together. Yeah.
Even strangers, you will reach
out? Oh yes, actually, I reached out to a stranger. We never met before. But through phone, we talk, and through SMS, we talk about it. I just share the journey because it's not easy for people who diagnosed with cancer. The moment when you hear that you diagnosed it, your whole world is collected. So I just want to walk with them, with them together.
Come alongside to encourage.
Yes.
So after service, after serving, after making a decision to serve, now you look back, any regrets? Starting with Jean. Say no.
No regrets. Have to say no. They have no regrets. I believe I maybe should have started earlier than just 2 years ago. Because I've been in church for a long time, for about 25 years. And I realized through serving, I actually grow. It's strangely really grow. And you can see God's hand in your life, my family's life, and even in the lives of my cell group members. And I always thought that it's really difficult because in your 30s, you have career, you have kids. And kids are tiring. It's tiring, they take up your energy. But God gave us our kids. And we cannot let, I mean for us, we cannot let our kids be the reason that we don't serve. Because there's always excuses. I mean, I believe my 20s, I will have excuses. 30s, 40s, 50s. There will be never a good time to say, okay, I want to serve. So I decided to take the leap of faith to say, okay, I'm going to serve. I'm not going to let these reasons and excuses to stand in the way.
Thank you. Esther, any regrets?
Must say no, right?
Say no. According to the script.
No, there's no regret. The only fear and regret I will have is I missed the chance of sharing. So I always grab the opportunity whenever I can to share with anybody. Yeah.
Thank you. Any last, if you're given a chance now, to tell our family, is there a last thing that you want to tell us?
It is not impossible to serve. Even you have young kids, you have career to juggle. God is all powerful, and all things are possible with Him. He will give you the strength to serve. You just have the leap of faith to say that, Yes, God, please use me as an instrument, and He will use you in ways that we cannot imagine. And to start, to really have the leap of faith to say, okay, I will try, and I'll start.
Take the first step.
Yes, take the first step.
Esther?
Never fear to serve. Never give up, because God is with us, and He definitely with you when you serve.
Amen. 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 Church, can you thank our two friends for sharing with us? So you heard life story. I did not arm twist them to share what they say. You hear a story stepping out to serve even with young kids. It's not impossible. They need to make some adjustment, but God can take care of the rest. And you hear a story from Esther. Not in perfect health, but that's not a good reason not to serve. Step out to serve in the capacity that you can, and God will take care of the rest. Because of their service, people came to know the Lord. Because of their service, their children are exposed to what it means to serve others. There is never a good time to serve. Every day is the best time to serve. So the 4 points I share with you, can you remember? Keep your head clear, pray. Keep your heart warm, love. Keep your home or purse open. Share. And keep your hands busy. Serve. But 1 Peter 4 did not end at 11 because it continues 12 to 19. Verse 12 says, "Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trials when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice in so far as you share Christ's suffering, that you may also rejoice and be glad when His glory is revealed. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of the Lord rests upon you. But let none of you suffer as a murderer or thief or evildoer or as a meddler. Verse 16, yet if anyone suffers as Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name. We see that in Esther, right? For it is time for judgment to begin at the household of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if the righteous is scarcely saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good. We live in a fallen world. There's suffering, there's trials, there's misunderstanding, and cause pain, hurts, and imperfection in our life. My last point is, but keep your hope alive. We need to persevere. Peter, in 1 Peter chapter 4, started off by highlighting Jesus suffered for us. He ended off chapter 4 by reminding us, if we go through suffering, remember to persevere. Remember to persevere. Laura and Martin were two newly married couples. They thought the world was open to them. They could do anything they want because God has gifted them. She was doing well in music ministry, and they are trusting God for phenomenal ministry. But 2 years after they get married, Martin, the husband, begin to experience some physical symptoms in his life. He will fall asleep in class and often display some forgetfulness. At first, they dismiss this is perhaps they are too tired, but the symptoms persist, so they decided to check it out. And to their horror, doctors told them that Martin have a brain tumor. So they were sitting in the neurosurgeon office, listening to him, explaining the risk that comes with the complicated surgery. Martin faced the possibility of complete amnesia or even death, but he decided to go through the surgery. He survived, but he suffered some memory and vision loss. The couple discovered that what it means to live according to God's grace through that period. After several years of some of this disability not improving, the couple come to terms with the reality that their challenges is not a detour, but is the road itself. Despite their difficulties, the couple kept serving in areas they could. They always stay cheerful, knowing that they can continue to trust Him when life is not perfect. What began as a tragedy has become an opportunity for them to take the positive step forward in their faith and trust Him for ministry. Laura penned a song as she reflected on the journey, and this is a song I want you to listen. Can we have the song, please?
We pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity, and we pray for your mighty hand, ease our suffering. And all the while you hear each spoken need. Yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? When friends betray us, when darkness seems to win, we know the pain reminds this heart that this is not our home. It's not our home. What if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if my greatest disappointments or the achings of this life is the revealing of a greater thirst this world can't satisfy? And what if trials of this life, the rain, the storms, the hardest nights, are your mercies in disguise?
What if my greatest disappointments or the aching of this life is a revealing of a greater thirst that this world cannot satisfy? And if you hear clearly the song, he say our God will never give us lesser things. Romans 8:28 says, and we know that God causes everything, the good things, the not so good things, to work together for the good of those who love God and who are called according to his purpose for them. When you invite God into your situation, God will bring along with him mercy, grace, power, provision, and blessing. And he will weave your struggles, he will weave your pain, you're with your suffering and your disappointment. So at the end of the day, he gets the glory, you enjoy the peace. I asked my daughter how to close the time. This is what she has for all of us. She says, stay awake so that you will be alert, to be prepared to make room for your master anytime. Be hopeful, always pray, always serve, always share as much as you can. Love those around you and persevere in everything you do for him and for others. So make room for the master, people. Keep your head clear, pray. Keep your heart warm, love. Keep your home open, share. Keep your hands busy, serve. Keep your hope alive, persevere. Can I have the worship team up? This week, the whole nation mourned for the passing of a very young, talented actor. It just bring home to the point that life is short. Your end and my end can be before the end. So we need to treasure our time. Treasure the time that God has given us to step up and serve. Today is always the best time to serve. Don't wait until sometime later, because sometime later may not come. Revelation 3:20 is a powerful verse that changed my life many, many years ago. And the verse states that someone is knocking. Jesus is knocking. He said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock." And that verse changed my life because I invited Jesus into my life. And ever since then, I realized that Jesus keep knocking at my door, because I realized there's many rooms in my life. There's a room to my head. There's a room to my heart. There's a room to what I have. There's a room to my hands. And there's a room to my hope. And many, many more rooms. So He is knocking at my door, and I'm sure He's knocking at all your doors today. Jesus said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock." He says, if you hear me, if you hear my knocking, He wants you to open the door. All you need to do is to open the door, because He said He will come in and fellowship with you and dine with you, and He will bring along His strength for you, His gifting, His empowerment, blessing, provision, because all He wants is to take residence in that room of your life. So I challenge you, church, step up. It's beginning of 2019. Don't wait until 2020, then we decide. Let's step up together as a church. Serve together, share together, love together, so that God's grace can flow. His whole spectrum of varied grace can flow among us, through us, and beyond us to the community.